Alrighty, so up to this point, we've talked about several different phases of flight and how an aircraft performs during them. So just to recap, we've talked about steady level flight, and we've talked about the thrust required and the power required to maintain steady level flight. We've also talked about the power available, and we've talked about climbing flight, and we've also talked about what happens if we lose power? And we talked about glide ratio and sink rate. And in other words, how long can we stay in the air if we've lost power? And how to maximize time in the air? And also, how far can we go? And how to maximize the distance traveled if we've lost power? We've also talked about turning and some of the performance parameters that are involved there, such as the turning radius. The turning rate, the maximum bank angle, and things like that. So now what we're going to talk about is takeoff and landing performance. So let me just write this down. Takeoff and landing performance. And in particular, today we're going to talk about essentially the distance traveled on the ground before takeoff and the distance needed or the distance traveled on the ground in landing, which will then, of course, translate into the length of runway needed for takeoff or for landing. And really, the equations that we use for takeoff and landing are the same. So we're going to focus this section mostly on takeoff, and then I'll just quickly go over later on how we can apply that to landing. So let's talk a little bit about takeoff. Okay, so let's say we're on a nice green airstrip. Make that a little bit thinner. Okay, so here's our airstrip, and just to denote here, this is solid ground. You should hope, right? If we're going to take off, we want to take off of solid ground. Okay, so there's a few different phases that we need to consider here. So let me attempt to draw an aircraft here. This is going to be a funny looking aircraft, guys. There's its propeller, and here's its wing. Okay, and it just has some tricycle landing gears. Okay, forgive my really ugly aircraft. So here we have the aircraft on the ground. It's going to start from zero velocity. Okay, that's its ground speed starts at zero velocity. And it's going to start accelerating. So the velocity is going to start increasing until it gets to the liftoff speed, or very close to the liftoff speed. At which time, the pilot is going to input some elevator deflection, and the airplane is going to start to rotate. So again, I'm going to attempt to draw this. That's a really ugly airplane. The propeller. And now you see it's rotating a little bit, okay? Because there's some elevator deflection that's been put in. And then it enters this phase where it begins to rotate until the angle of attack and the lift coefficient are high enough that the airplane takes off. So here's our airplane. A little bit prettier that time. I mean, marginally prettier. And now the airplane is no longer touching the ground. The lift is now greater than or equal to the weight, and we take off. Let me just kind of, sorry, I drew lift here. I didn't really want that. Okay, and here again, it's still at the liftoff speed, but now it's rotated enough that the lift coefficient is high enough, and the aircraft takes off. So there's two different phases that we've highlighted here. The first we're going to call S sub a, which is the acceleration phase. And the second we're going to call s sub r, which is the rotation phase. And the entire distance that we've traveled here from zero velocity to liftoff, we'll call the ground roll. Okay, so sg is the ground roll. And sg is just the sum of the acceleration phase plus the rotation phase. So acceleration phase and this is the rotation phase. Okay, so we'll come back to this figure again. This is just kind of a conceptual schematic, okay, of takeoff and the ground roll. So let's scroll down. In this video, we're going to focus on the acceleration phase. So I'm going to change colors now. We're going to go to red. Let's just underline that, acceleration phase. Okay, so during the acceleration phase, there are some forces acting on our aircraft. So we're gonna go ahead and draw a free body diagram. We'll draw our aircraft in white. I'm gonna draw a different airplane this time. It's not so ugly, hopefully. Okay, so here's an airplane, a little more like what maybe I usually draw. And it's on the ground. These are its landing gear. Okay, so there's some forces acting on this airplane, which, as usual, I'll do in blue. But first, the aircraft. We're just going to put this line here. This is the velocity, okay? I like to do that in different colors so that it stands out apart from the forces, okay? Anyway, there's the velocity. Okay, so as far as forces go, we have our typical forces. So we have our thrust, which acts wherever the engine is. And here we're going to assume that the thrust angle is zero. So it's the thrust is aligned in the direction of travel. Lift, which acts straight up, perpendicular to the velocity. Drag, which acts straight back, parallel to the velocity. Weight, which acts straight down, as usual. And then now we have this other force that acts right here, or we're going to put it here, which is the friction force, or the force of rolling friction. So let me label all these real quick. So here we have our thrust, here we have our lift, here we have our weight, we have our drag, and this is what we're going to call F sub R, which is rolling friction. Okay, and of course, I didn't draw this before, but let's go back to our green ground. The aircraft here is, of course, still on the ground. Okay, so if we do we're going to do a force balance, but we have to remember now that we are in accelerating flight, or accelerating, we are accelerating forward, okay? So when we do our force balance, we use Newton's second law, force equals mass times acceleration. Okay, so let's start with this piece, this mass times acceleration piece. So the mass of the aircraft, we can say is W over G, okay? And then the acceleration is the derivative of the velocity with respect to time. Okay, now we can do some things with this, okay? So, well, first I want to point something out. So this velocity here is actually the ground velocity, okay, V sub G. Now, in the absence of wind, the ground velocity is the same as the airspeed. But if there's wind, then the ground velocity is different than the airspeed. So we're going to write this in general terms. This really is W over G times the airspeed minus V sub HW, which is the headwind velocity. Okay, so this is the velocity coming at or from behind the aircraft. Of course, if headwind is negative, it's a tailwind, right? But we're going to assume that the headwind is constant. In which case, I wrote this wrong. Let me correct something really quick. So you probably caught this, and I just went right past it. So we have W over G times D dt of V minus V headwind. There, that's better. Now we're assuming that the headwind is constant in time. So what this means then is we have W over G dV dt. Okay, so this is a subtle difference. We've gone from the ground speed to the airspeed. And the reason for that is because we said that the headwind velocity is constant. Now I want to emphasize this term here on the right does not mean we don't have headwind. It just means that we have a constant headwind. Okay? Okay, now I'm going to go to a new line here so that we can kind of clear this up. So now we have our mass times acceleration. So our mass, which is W over G, times our acceleration, dV over dt. And that, of course, is equal to the sum of the forces. So let's look at our forces. We have we're looking at forces in the direction of travel. So we have our thrust minus the drag minus the coefficient of rolling friction. The rolling friction force, which we'll talk about and how it's related to the coefficient of rolling friction. All right, so we're going to call this equation star. Because we want to remember it. All right, let's scroll down a little bit. So remember, we're looking at the acceleration phase of the ground roll. All right. Okay, so let's look at our dV dt term. We're going to do some clever things here. So velocity, of course, is a distance traveled over a unit of time, right? So by applying the chain rule, we're going to stick with our convention that S is a distance traveled. So applying the chain rule, we can say that dV dt is the same as dV ds times ds dt. And noting that ds dt is the same as our velocity. So let me write this. ds dt equals v minus v headwind. So this is our ground speed. So using that here, we can rewrite dv ds times ds dt as, I'm going to rearrange the order here, v, so replacing ds dt with this v minus vhw, we have v minus vhw times dv ds. Okay, so now we have dV dt equals V minus VHW dV ds. Now plugging that in here, where we have dV dt, so plug into star, we can rewrite star as W over G times V minus V headwind. That's HW, by the way, it's kind of ugly writing, times V dV ds equals T minus D minus F sub R. And we can rearrange this to give us ds dV. So I've rearranged and now I've got ds dV on one side. And that's going to equal W over G times V minus V headwind, all divided by T minus D minus F sub R. Okay, now this equation is something we can do something with this, okay? we have now the derivative of the distance with respect to velocity, and that equals some function of our forces and velocity. So if we want to find the total distance traveled, then we just got to integrate this, okay? Now, I want to emphasize, this equation is used to find a distance traveled between two separate velocities, okay? So we're going to denote this. What we're going to do is we're going to separate variables. So we're going to take the dv over to the right-hand side, and we're going to integrate. So we have from, well, we're going to integrate ds equals the integral of w over g b minus v headwind divided by t minus d minus f sub r dv. Now, as I said, we've integrated this, but we're going to integrate this over a velocity interval. Okay, so from v sub I, which is some initial velocity, to some velocity at the next step, or vi plus 1, we're going to do that on both sides. And so what this comes out to be then is si plus 1 minus s sub I equals w over g. And here we've assumed that the weight does not change during takeoff. What that means then is we're assuming that there's no fuel burned, or that the fuel burn is negligible during takeoff, which in some cases is a good assumption. In others, the weight burn, the fuel burn during takeoff is more significant, but we're going to just assume that it's negligible. Times integral of v, integral from vi to vi plus 1 of v minus v headwind divided by t minus d minus f sub r dv. Now we're going to remember this equation, okay? This is an extremely important equation that we're going to use throughout, okay? So again, I want to emphasize this is a single distance interval, okay? So if we have, you know, some interval here, or some distance, our acceleration distance, but our velocity and our forces change with a function of velocity, which they do, and we'll talk a little bit about that more later. If we really want to get a good approximation here, we're going to apply this equation over a whole series of discrete intervals. Okay? And that's going to give us a good approximation. So in general, we apply this over several intervals to get our acceleration distance. Now, there are special cases where our velocity, our thrust, and our drag, and our friction are functions, are well-behaved functions of velocity. And we can integrate this without discretizing the interval up. We can integrate this analytically. And we'll discuss some of those later on. But at any rate, we're going to end here with this equation. And later on, we'll talk a little bit more about how to apply it.